Good morning, everyone, and welcome to DNA Day. Thank you for taking the time to attend. This web event is organized by Let's Talk Science and the Biodiversity Institute of Ontario. Let's Talk Science works across Canada to engage youth through science, technology, engineering, and math. You can learn more at letstalkscience.ca. My name is Bob Hanner, and this morning I'm joined by colleagues Amanda Naaum and Jeff Farber. And we'll talk to you about our work on DNA-based identification of species. I'm going to now move to my presentation. And are we seeing it live? Are you seeing the presentation?
Are we on mute?
Okay, it's not showing up. Let me go back to screen share. And this one. Okay. So this is the Biodiversity Institute of Ontario and Center for Biodiversity Genomics, where we're broadcasting live this morning for DNA Day. Again, my name is Bob Hanner. I'm an associate professor here in the Department of Integrative Biology. And I'm going to talk to you about DNA barcodes and food security and some of the work that we're doing here at the Biodiversity Institute. But first, we have to talk a bit about species. It was Carl Linnaeus who first gave us binomial nomenclature through his Systema Natura, where we began to use scientific names to formally describe the diversity around us. About 100 years later, it was Charles Darwin who gave us a mechanism for the existence of species. His thesis of descent with modification by natural selection helped us to understand that species exist because they've evolved. Some species are older than others and are more easily told apart by their morphology. This is also true of their DNA. One of the challenges we have with identifying species is that specimens come in many forms, but most of our taxonomic keys are written for adult, usually male specimens. And this makes it difficult to identify sexually dimorphic species or juvenile stages like eggs and larvae or processed products using traditional morphological approaches. Fortunately, DNA-based identifications work on all forms. The concept is fairly simple. We can build a lookup table of species names and sequences derived from expert identified reference specimens. We can then sequence an unknown, compare to our database, and infer a species name based on a sequence match. This was first proposed in a paper in 1992 by Canadian scientists Sylvia Bartlett and Willie Davidson in a paper entitled Forensically Important Nucleotide Sequences. And was more recently scaled up and popularized by my colleague Paul Hebert here at the Biodiversity Institute of Ontario in 2003 with the publication of his paper, Biological Identifications Through DNA Barcodes. The advance that Paul brought to the field was identifying a short standard gene region that could be used to tell species apart and bringing an informatics platform to bear to allow us to easily build this lookup table to have a tool for identifying species globally. So DNA barcoding is a method of species identification and discovery based on DNA sequences derived from standard marker genes. The idea is that for that gene segment, every species will have a unique sequence or a unique assemblage of closely related sequences, which is termed a DNA barcode. We use different marker genes for different groups of animals because the rates of molecular evolution can differ for different genes and different target species. So the mitochondrial cytochrome oxidase 1 gene is commonly used for animals, while a pair of chloroplast markers, RBCL and MAPK, are used to barcode plants, and an intergenic spacer region is commonly used for fungal identification. Barcoding works when variation between species is high and variation within species is low. What we typically see is very little variation within a species. If you look at the top left corner, you'll see that the horizontal bar refers to the amount of genetic divergence between specimens, and typically species share the same barcode. Whereas if you look at the lower right-hand corner, when we're looking at the sequences of different species, there are deep genetic divergences between them. This is the basis for how barcoding works. The Barcode of Life Data Systems is the information platform for DNA barcode data that we host here at the University of Guelph and is used by scientists around the world as a workbench to put in sequence data derived from expert-identified reference specimens. And there is also an online identification feature that allows us to put in the sequence of an unknown and query it against the database to obtain an ID. Most of the work that we do here in building the barcode reference library is working with taxonomists from around the world, obtaining specimens from museums and herbaria, and sometimes even freshly collected from the field, where we'll take the data of who collected it, when and where, along with the high-resolution digital photograph and GPS coordinates, and put that into the database, and then at the same time take a small tissue sample, usually about the size of a grain of rice, from each specimen, extract DNA from it, PCR amplify the barcode gene and sequence it, and then put that sequence in the database along with that specimen's provenance data. DNA barcoding requires a reference library for unknowns or for known species, and it can serve as a master key that can help us identify all life stages. We can do these identifications quickly and cheaply with relatively little residual taxonomic uncertainty. We've used this kind of technology in conducting things like market surveys. Some of you have participated in these kinds of activities, and Amanda Naaum will talk to you more about the work we've done in this space in her talk shortly. To summarize how a market survey works, we sequence a piece of tissue from sushi or filet obtained at a restaurant or grocery store, get its DNA barcode, compare that barcode to the library to get a scientific name, and then we look into the Canadian Food Inspection Agency's list of acceptable market names for that species and determine whether or not that particular species can be sold under that market name. If not, we consider the sample mislabeled. And we've shown that there's been significant amounts of seafood fraud in North America using this approach. In our early tests, barcoding showed that about 25% of seafood tested was potentially mislabeled. And in some cases, higher levels of mislabeling were revealed, for example, with red snapper. And typically, the pattern we find is that a species of a lower economic value is substituted for one of a higher market value, what we would consider to be economically motivated food adulteration, or more commonly referred to as food fraud. This represents an impediment to consumer choice when overfished species are sold as more common species. But not only are there economic implications, but there are environmental concerns with how we manage these stocks. Importantly, we've also worked with the U.S. Food and Drug Administration to identify cases where people have been poisoned by mislabeled seafood. In this paper, people bought what they thought was monkfish and ended up in critical condition in the hospital in Chicago. The Food and Drug Administration recovered a meal remnant from their stove as a kind of fish soup. So they sent it to Guelph, and we barcoded it and showed that it was pufferfish. FDA then did a toxicity screen and found tetrodotoxin, which is the toxin produced by pufferfish, so that we had two different lines of evidence corroborating each other, suggesting that it wasn't monkfish that the couple bought. It was, in fact, pufferfish. So in addition to economic and environmental concerns with this kind of seafood fraud, we also see public health challenges arising from it as well. We're also working to build barcode libraries for many other species, including things like pests of quarantine significance that negatively impact our agricultural production and challenge our ability to safely and securely produce food for a planet's population that's rapidly approaching 9 billion. My colleague Amanda Naaum will talk a bit about some of the tools she's used to bring this to point of contact, simplifying the barcoding procedure so that it can be conducted at point of need in real time. And also want to mention that we're working closely with the Canadian Food Inspection Agency to help expand their repertoire of food testing to include mixed meats and other foods that we've also seen evidence of mislabeling and fraud. With that, I'll close my presentation and would like to introduce my colleague, Amanda Naaum, who will talk to you about her work.
So good morning, everyone. My name is Amanda Naaum, and I am the senior research scientist at TRU-ID, which is a company that does testing for food authentication here in Guelph. So today I'm going to talk to you about seafood identification using DNA and focus on a couple of different case studies, including the DNA barcoding market survey that was conducted this year with Let's Talk Science and a few of the key results from that, as well as some of the portable point of need testing that Dr. Hannah has just described that we've been developing over the past few years. So I want to start off by explaining a little bit about why it's so important to do this type of testing in seafood. So for the global seafood industry, right now, in 2016, 146 million tons of seafood was harvested. That represents about a quarter of the entire global protein intake around the world. About a tenth of the people on the face of the planet rely on fish or fisheries in some way for their direct livelihood, and about 90% of those fisheries are either fully or overexploited. So we really are in a kind of a crisis in how do we maintain and sustain this industry. In addition, with seafood products, you have a complicated global supply chain. Products often go through multiple countries that each have their own regulation for those types of products. There can be many, many different processing steps. And what you end up having is traceability or an attempt to try and track these products through this really complex supply chain. But oftentimes, a factor of authenticity isn't actually introduced. But that's really, really important because from the FDA, for example, in the United States, there are more than 1,800 different species of fish that are on their fish list and sold or can be sold commercially in that country alone. So species identification becomes really important for regulatory compliance, but also for monitoring human health, for economics, because different species cost different amounts of money and can sell for different amounts of money. And also, as I mentioned, for conservation, because we definitely can't regulate or manage stocks unless we know what the correct identification of the fish that are actually coming out of the water are. So species mislabeling, where one species is labeled and sold as another, is a threat to consumers and to the sustainability of the seafood harvest and production globally as well. And seafood mislabeling is not a new phenomenon. So this is an excerpt from an article from 1915 explaining how sharks were caught and cut up and ended up being sold as swordfish steaks. So the studies of seafood fraud have increased over time since then, and you can see there's a very sharp increase in the number of studies after DNA barcoding. And that's because the process of DNA barcoding gives us a way of quickly and easily, or relatively quickly and easily, testing seafood samples that don't have those morphological characteristics to be able to tell the species apart, but being able to actually search the DNA, compare it to the sequence library in bold, and get an identification from a market sample. So this is one of the first DNA barcoding market surveys that was done in North America. Since then, it's been adopted as a regulatory tool by the FDA, and high school students are using DNA barcoding in various studies in North America and around the world. There's ongoing media coverage, so you may have seen a media article or report about the incidents and impacts of seafood mislabeling. And there have been DNA barcoding market surveys done on every continent around the world. So what we've generally found with these studies that's already kind of been covered is around 25% or more at some times of high-value species are fraudulently labeled, and that fraud can happen at various different points in that complicated supply chain for seafood. And we've seen economic impacts where species of a lower value are being substituted and sold as one of a higher value, some of environmental impact where an endangered species is being sold as a sustainable option, and also health impacts like the pufferfish example that you just heard about. So Let's Talk Science has engaged in several different market surveys of seafood with high school students, and I'm going to go over a couple of the key results and processes for the most recent one that has just been completed. So for this market survey, students purchased fresh or frozen fish at their local markets and grocery stores. They were placed into vials and shipped here to the University of Guelph for analysis. And we used DNA barcoding standard processes of DNA extraction, amplification with PCR, and then finally getting the DNA barcode sequence. Those sequences were then searched in the DNA barcode library in bold, and an identification was made for all of the different species. So were the fish correctly labeled? We had about 250 samples submitted, and from those, 207 were able to actually be used. So there were some issues with samples, both from a technical perspective and just in terms of what was actually collected. But we had more than 200 successful DNA barcodes, and 80% of those were correctly labeled. From the other 20%, 12% had a name that was not on the CFIA fish list. So this could be a case of mislabeling, but it also could mean that that species is just not yet recognized by the Canadian regulatory agency as a species that can be sold in Canada. So this kind of illustrates a little bit about how it's a complex question of mislabeling. The other 8% were actually sold under the wrong name. So both the scientific name and the common name were found on the CFIA fish list. So that's the regulatory body that governs seafood identification in Canada. And those are examples where it is very likely to be some type of mislabeling going on. So I'm going to go through two examples of kind of true mislabeling of this, we're pretty sure something's happening, and also how it can be a very complicated question as well with the naming. So for true mislabeling, one of the samples came in labeled as its market label as sockeye salmon. The DNA barcode match, though, was for Salmo salar, which is Atlantic salmon. So this species is usually farmed. Both sockeye salmon and Atlantic salmon are on the CFIA fish list, and it's very clear what those are able to be called as a market name. So this is a case where sockeye salmon, which is wild caught and usually commands a higher price, has been substituted with Atlantic salmon that can be a much lower price. In the name nonconformity category, one of the samples was actually labeled wild sole. The DNA barcode match came back as Lepidopsida polyxystra, which is not on the CFIA fish list, but using other sources, we could find that that actually is the species name for northern rock sole, which is still a type of sole. So this is a case where you have a sole that's been market labeled as wild sole, but this doesn't match the regulatory database within the country, in this case Canada, for regulating and labeling seafood. So this is in case where, is it because the seafood list is not up to date? Is it because there's some reason that that species shouldn't be sold in Canada? Basically, these are cases where some more sort of more information needs to be received about the sample, and it needs to be looked into a little bit further. So we're not always seeing clear-cut issues with mislabeling, and sometimes it can be a consideration of the naming conventions that are being used. So in general, from the impacts of these mislabeling events, is that for people, we may be unknowingly exposed to toxins or allergens in certain cases, and we may be paying more than we should be paying for a certain species. So sometimes there's no real health risk, but we should be knowing what we're actually buying. In the environmental case, for fish populations, including for species at risk, they may be negatively impacted if they're being caught, but that's not being recorded properly. And also fish may as a result not be harvested in a sustainable manner if we don't know, again, what we're pulling out of the ocean. So some of the challenges around using DNA barcoding for seafood identification come where you're looking at severely degraded DNA or mixtures of products like you might see with a canned salmon or tuna product. There are cases where you need an answer much more quickly, so you're dealing with a perishable commodity like seafood, might need to have an answer more quickly than sending a sample out for DNA barcoding and waiting for a result to come back. And also, oftentimes, testing needs to be able to be done in the field and by non-experts. So not everyone within the seafood industry is going to have the capacity or capability to send samples off or interpret the results that are coming back in. So in these cases, we can employ a method called real-time PCR. And this is something that I've been working on extensively throughout my PhD and now in my current industry position. And what this does is takes a smaller portion of the DNA barcode, and uses a reference library of DNA barcodes, for example, to actually build species-specific primers. So we're looking at a very, very short part of the DNA barcode that's specific to a certain species that we're looking for. And what that lets you do is use a fluorescent probe to do real-time detection. So this actually shows amplification and PCR all in one go. No post-PCR processing steps, and you can see the result output is really, really simple. So we have a positive sample kind of with the curve there that you can see, and then the negative sample is that flat line. So really simple, positive or negative, either that species is there or not. So you eliminate a lot of the steps that are involved with DNA barcoding, and you're able to do things a lot quickly and then address some of these challenges. So because we're using a smaller piece of DNA, we can do mixtures and severely degraded DNA. Oftentimes, the entire process for real-time PCR can be done all the way through from DNA extraction to analysis in about an hour and a half. And it allows you to do field testing and testing by non-experts because it's very simple and because there are a wide range of portable testing options available, so instrumentation that can actually be ported around with you. So this is an example of one of the kits that we've developed with Instant Labs and the University of Guelph. And it shows a little bit of what you'd be expecting for these kind of simplified real-time PCR kits. So you have an instrument that is much smaller that can be taken around with you. And more importantly, there's a kit with all of the reagents that you need, freeze-dried and color-coded. So it takes a lot of the kind of complexity of the scientific analysis out of the equation. And building these tests now for industry is what I do for my job. So my work now focuses on developing both DNA barcoding and sequencing-based testing, but also on-site testing capabilities for different companies to be able to certify that their seafood products are DNA tested. And that kind of helps them mitigate some of the risks that are associated with seafood fraud. And that's pretty much it.
Thank you, Amanda. Just want to confirm that everything is still working well and people are hearing us as we bring up the next presentation from my colleague, Dr. Jeff Farber.
Thank you very much, Bob. I think we'll switch gears a little here. My name is Jeff Farber. I'm in Department of Food Science, and I work actually in the area of food safety. And so I work with all those bad bugs that some of you may have heard about, things like Listeria, Salmonella, and E. coli. Every year in Canada, it's estimated there are 4 million cases of foodborne illness. So if you're in a class there of 8 or 10 people, it's likely that one of you in that room will come down with foodborne illness every year. It's unusual in that of the 4 million cases, the actual cause of illness is only known for 1.6 million of those cases. So we still have a lot of work to do to figure out what is causing a lot of the foodborne illness that's going on. And we hope with some of the new technologies that we will be able to do that. Now, a lot of people think that you just get very mild illness, like diarrhea or vomiting for a day or two, and that's it. But we now know that there can be very, very serious illness that can occur after the initial insult of the diarrhea. So you could get things like arthritis for several months after foodborne illness. You can get neurological symptoms, kidney disorders, bowel disorders, and death, even death can occur with foodborne illness. Some of you may have seen this was very recently, this was an outbreak that occurred in Canada. This was Robin Hood flour that was contaminated with a pathogenic strain of E. coli. There were 25 illnesses that occurred in four provinces. And this was our famous maple leaf listeriosis outbreak, which occurred in 2008. In its outbreak, there were 57 cases and 24 deaths, unfortunately, in this particular outbreak. So how do we actually make use of some of DNA technologies in the food safety area? That's what I'll try to point out in some of my slides, how we actually use this technology. So for example, let's say when we're trying to solve foodborne outbreaks, that is what's actually causing an outbreak, what we would do is we would get, for example, we take our deli meat, we would try to isolate listeria from that deli meat, and we'd get an isolate on a plate. And then we'd isolate an isolate from a patient, and this usually is either from the blood or cerebral spinal fluid. And then we would do DNA typing on both the clinical isolate and the food isolate to see if there is actually a match. So this is some of the things that we're doing in the DNA space, and I'll go over a little more a little later. So what's happened is that we used to use some older technologies, which I'll show you in a little while, but we now use whole genome sequencing, where we're actually determining the complete DNA sequence of an organism's genome at a single time. And this has really revolutionized the whole field of looking at, for example, solving foodborne illness outbreaks much, much more quickly than we could in the past. And many of you are aware, when we say whole genome sequencing or refer to it as next generation sequencing, we're really determining the whole DNA sequence of, let's say, a bacteria like E. coli or listeria. We can use this to do a number of things. So, for example, we could use it to detect mutations. We could use it to find, let's say, if there's a few bases that have been inserted into the chromosome or deleted from a chromosome, we could look at that as well. And what we do when we compare actually genomes, we look for what we refer to as single base changes among the nucleotides within the DNA. And when we do this, it's referred to as single nucleotide polymorphisms, so single nucleotide changes, or referred to that as SNPs. And here you can see roughly here, so you may get a change from, let's say, a C, a cytosine, to a T, thymine, for example. So that single change could signify that there are differences between the two organisms that you're looking at in terms of the whole DNA composition of that particular organism. If we look at, for example, the scientific publications on whole genome sequencing, you can see a tremendous increase from 2010 to 2016, when we had over 11,000 publications on whole genome sequencing. And this largely, both the speed has really increased in terms of how fast we can do whole genome sequencing, and the cost has come down tremendously. And that's why we're seeing much more increased use of whole genome sequencing in the whole area of microbiology. And you can see here a number of publications where whole genome sequencing is starting to be used quite dramatically in the food safety area, and it will continue to be used even more so in the future. Here you can see increased reports of outbreaks, for example, that have been identified through whole genome sequencing. So you can see up there on the left, they used whole genome sequencing to detect the salmonella outbreak. And on the bottom, you can see they used it to detect the listeria outbreak due to smoked fish consumption. If you look at, this is a genome tracker database. This is a database established in the United States. And what they do is a lot of people send them microorganisms and they actually sequence them and add them to the database. And scientists around the world can actually use that to look and compare their strains with what the strains are in the genome tracker database. And quite dramatically, if you look at the average number of whole genome sequencings that were added to this database in 2013, it was 169. And now in 2016, they add over 4,000 sequences per month to the database. So you can see a dramatic increase in how this is being used. And so it's really created a whole new shift, a paradigm shift. So in the past, we used to have to do, when we do serotyping, for example, to look at the exact type of, let's say, Listeria salmonella, we have to do agglutination on a slide, or we'd have to do special testing to look at antimicrobial resistance. But now we could just look at the actual DNA bases, so the whole genome sequencing of the bacteria, and we can see, for example, yes, we have a gene, for example, for ampicillin resistance. So if we can look at it right at the whole genome sequencing and predict that without having to do actual tests, further tests in the lab. And so the same with serotyping as well. So really, whole genome sequencing is proved to be a very, very efficient forensic tool for microbiologists. And so, for example, you can see here some of the things, API, for example, we used to use that for, and we still do sometimes, to look at the biochemical reactions and try to distinguish bacteria down to the species level. Now it's much easier when we're using whole genome sequencing just to look at the DNA sequence of the microorganism and not having to do these special biochemical tests. Also, before whole genome sequencing, the source of contamination of a food was often not clear. So for example, if you look at the bars on the right-hand side, that was a technique called pulse-filled gel electrophoresis, where you get bands of DNA out on a gel. But if you look at those bands, especially in the middle, sometimes it was very, very hard to distinguish, was that a single band or was it not? And so we could not really differentiate between two different types of microorganisms. But now with whole genome sequencing, where we're looking at comparing nucleotides, it's much more efficient and we have a much higher level of confidence. Also with illnesses, before whole genome sequencing, we were source of contamination was usually found after the illness. So you can see the illness peaks in the purple bars there in the middle. And sometimes the source of contamination was identified too late to prevent most of the illnesses in the outbreak. But now with whole genome sequencing, because we can get earlier identification of the source of contamination, we can prevent a lot of those illnesses from occurring. We can stop the outbreak in its tracks. One thing I just wanted to point out to you, although whole genome sequencing is a very good tool, we still need to use it with, for example, epidemiological investigation, where epidemiologists actually ask people what they ate, and they try to figure out just on the basis of some statistical analysis. So we need to use that epidemiological evidence along with whole genome sequencing. The other tool that we're using very often is not only for identifying the cause of foodborne outbreaks, but also looking at how we can characterize some isolates from food and the environment within food plants. So for example, we have some studies going on where we're looking, for example, at Listeria monocytogenes in the fields where produce is growing, and we can track actually how the organism's actually moving into the field and into the final product.
Jeff, I just got a text that they're not seeing your slides. We need to escape back out of this. And I think I have to hit the screen share again. Why is it not giving us that opportunity to go to the slides? Yeah, we can't actually see the chat once the slides are up. So that's been the challenge for us. Sorry about that.
Okay. So I'll just finish off then. Another use of DNA that has been used quite widely in the food safety area is the whole microbiome world. So that is the whole collection communities of bacteria that make up our bodies and also that make up foods. There is a very big microbiome in foods. So for example, some companies are using this to look at, for example, all the bacteria that make up their cheese that they're producing. So if they want to make that cheese in another plant in another city, they can compare the microflora of that particular cheese with the microflora made in their particular plant. So a whole bunch of uses as well for DNA in terms of the microbiome that's being used in the food industry. So I think I'll stop at that point, Bob.
Okay. Thank you. So apologies for the glitch in the slides. For some reason, it stopped sharing the slide presentation. We switched from Amanda's to Jeff's. But we'd like to take a minute now to invite Megan and her students to introduce themselves and ask anyone watching to note that they can submit questions through letstalkdna.ca. And we would like to take questions that you may have for us based on the presentations.
Okay, hi everyone. I'm just gonna turn it over to some of my students to introduce us.
Hello, we're students from Nicholson Catholic College in Melville, Ontario.
We're grade 12 IB biology students.
And we took part in the fish market survey.
So we're gonna enter some questions now.
Having undergone extensive development in our understanding of genetics, what continues to be our limitation in curing genetic-based diseases?
What is our limitation in curing genetic-based diseases? That's a difficult question to address, and it depends, I think, in part on the disease in question. For some genetic mutations, for example, type 1 diabetes, where a patient doesn't produce insulin, we may know the actual genetic mutation that causes it, but that's kind of irrelevant. We can treat the diabetes with insulin. For other genetic diseases, we may not actually know what the cause is. So through whole genome sequencing, perhaps we can identify a defective gene, but developing gene therapies is not always as simple as producing insulin. So I think it depends in part on which diseases you're actually trying to cure. Just identifying a genetic disease doesn't obviously always lead to a cure, and some of them certainly will remain incurable. So obvious gross chromosomal abnormalities like trisomy X or Down syndrome, these are genetic diseases, but there will be no obvious cure for those, even though we understand the source of the problem. Jeff, did you have anything you wanted to add to that?
No, I think that's not my space really.
Yeah, not mine either, but it's a good question.
How does DNA profiling help scientists further understand evolution and genetics?
Excellent question. How does DNA profiling help scientists understand evolution and genetics? So as I mentioned at the beginning of my presentation, ever since Darwin, we've come to understand that species exist because they evolve. And over time, their appearances change, but they also accumulate mutations in their DNA. It's this accumulation of mutations in their DNA that allows us to tell their barcodes apart. The first thing that we want to ask in population genetics is how much standing genetic variation is in a species. So using these new DNA-based approaches, we can actually look for SNPs, as Dr. Farber was describing in his presentation. We can look for SNPs, or single nucleotide polymorphisms, in any different species, or even viruses. So looking at the number of mutations that different lineages have accumulated can allow us to calibrate a molecular clock and begin to estimate how old those species are. So for example, in the mitochondrial cytochrome oxidase 1 gene that we use for DNA barcoding animals, we see that there's about 2% sequence divergence, equates to about 1 million years of evolutionary diversification. Now these molecular clocks are not super precise. There are different things that can cause distortion in them. So things like metabolic rate, and body size seem to correlate with different rates of molecular evolution. But in general, we can look at the amount of sequence divergence in a DNA barcode and tell how old species are. So when we look at humans and chimps, we're about 5% sequence divergence in our barcode, and that would roughly correspond to, you know, a couple of million years of evolutionary diversification. And that's fairly consistent with fossil evidence.
I can just add a little bit from the bacteria standpoint as well. I think it is very important to look at the evolution. And we do see, for example, by doing this, we can sort of try to predict what's going to be the next emerging pathogen. So we could, for example, see which bacteria have lost genes or gained genes from other microorganisms. And I think it's good to know. So for example, let's say in a bacteria, you would have what we call a pathogenicity island. So this is a whole group of genes that are grouped together in a spot in the chromosome. And these genes together are responsible, for example, for causing illness in yourself. And you could actually get the transfer sometimes of these pathogenicity islands, this whole group of genes, from one bacteria to another. So you could make, let's say, bacteria that normally did not cause illness in humans now, because of this change, is now able to cause disease in humans. And we're able to look at all these genetic changes over time so that we can try to predict what's going to be the next emerging pathogen.
I can just add something quickly. So also for back to kind of the seafood authenticity side of things, as we're able to get more of this kind of information, we've been talking about species identification for seafood, but one of the really important factors can also be where the fish was caught, so geographic identification, all the way down to the population level. So as this type of testing, where you can get a lot more information and more of the genetic profile, it means that we can start building databases for population level identification for different seafood products as well. So that's going to be something from the sustainability side for that industry that will be really important.
Excellent point. Thanks, Amanda and Jeff, for your comments there. Next question.
I have one in regards to the seafood aspect, because one of the problems has been that we're overfishing, and then there's the relation with the misidentification and then fishing populations that are already endangered. How could the DNA profiling help prevent and maybe even maybe solve the problem of overfishing right now?
That's a good question. I think Amanda touched on that a bit in her presentation, but I'll try to take a stab at it from my view. If we see things like red snapper that are being overfished, and we're not actually getting accurate IDs on what's entering the market, then our catch statistics for those species are skewed. So there are lots of other species being substituted for red snapper. And if we just look at the catch statistics for red snapper on a whole, we might think that actually red snapper populations are doing very well. When in fact, what we're looking at is a whole bunch of different species coming in and being sold as red snapper. So any one of those individual species may not be doing so well. And part of the problem that we face here in North America is the challenge of linking species to common names. So snapper or sole is a good example. According to the Canadian Food Inspection Agency's fish list, more than 20 different species can be sold as sole. So perhaps your grandmother cooked sole, your mother cooked sole, maybe you'll go to the market one day and buy fillet of sole and cook it. What we found interesting is that sometimes things like tilapia are being sold as sole. They're not supposed to be. That's considered mislabeling and food fraud. But the vast majority of species that can legally be sold as sole, we've never actually encountered in the marketplace. So what I believe has happened is we've eaten one species after another to the brink of extinction. And then we just find another flaky white fleshed fish that we put on the market and call sole. So for the consumer, we assume, hey, this is a species that's been around for many years, must be sustainably harvested. And what we don't realize, because of this opacity in terms of understanding what species are being harvested as a result of this application of a common name to many species, masks the fact that a lot of these particular species have probably been overfished. Amanda, did you want to add anything to that?
No, I think that pretty much covers it really well.
When you collected the data, did you...
I'm sorry, can you speak up just a bit?
When you collected the data, did you also observe how the fish was bought, frozen or fresh? And if you did, is that... Does one section frozen or fresh fish, is it more proportionately mislabeled or not?
That's a good question. So whether or not we see differential rates of mislabeling between fresh or frozen product, we try to capture that information, but we don't always get it. We've recently engaged in a project with Canadian Food Inspection Agency to go beyond just retail. As scientists and consumers, all we can do is buy seafood at the market. Working with their inspectors, we were actually able to buy at the import, wholesale, and retail level. And while I don't have specific data on fresh versus frozen, we've seen incidents of mislabeling in both, but I don't think that we have a large enough sample size to say that they're significantly different in a statistical sense. What we have seen is evidence of mislabeling at import, and then that level of mislabeling jumps up from about 15 to about 30% at wholesale, and then ultimately jumps up again to about nearly 40% at retail. So we're seeing this compounding of fraud at multiple points in the supply chain. And that suggests that it's not only happening outside of Canada, but seafood is being mislabeled once it gets here as well. So these kinds of questions of looking at the factors of which species are more likely to be labeled or what degree of processing may be implicated in mislabeling are good questions that you ask. Clearly, the things that are more heavily processed are easier to disguise the fraud. You know, things that still have the head on have a lower level of mislabeling because we still have an opportunity to ID them morphologically. But once they're processed into fillets or surimi, the crab sticks and things like that, the artificial crab, obviously you can't identify them by morphology, and so it becomes much easier to commit fraud.
So it's my understanding that the root of the problem is where the fish is being sourced. So how is fraud and mislabeling going to be reinforced? What's keeping companies from not continuing to mislabel their fish?
So that's a good question. I think your assumption that the seafood is mislabeled at its source is questionable. I think the fishermen actually have a pretty good idea of what they're harvesting. But in the global seafood supply chain, we're moving through many different layers of processing. So for example, you may see a Chinese trawler collecting seafood off of the, say, the Canadian coast and processing it and sending it to be packaged in Russia, where it then moves through a number of wholesalers back into Canada for sale. So I don't think that the mislabeling is necessarily occurring dockside where the fishing occurs, although I think some of the cases where things like puffer fish get in, when you're pulling up a net with many tons of fish in it, that are mainly one school of fish with a few other species mixed in, that could be a case of mistaken identity, that it just runs through processing and, you know, that there it isn't deliberate. But where we're seeing species of a lower economic value substituted for ones of a higher economic value consistently, that's pretty clearly deliberately economically motivated food fraud. And I think that's largely happening during the processing and wholesaling of that material.
I can just add maybe to that. So the second part of your question, in terms of kind of what's keeping companies from doing this, if I heard correctly, I think is something that's worth also addressing. So a lot of times right now within the industry, what's being relied on it for traceability, so basically tracking those fish, which should in theory address the problem of mislabeling as well, is a paper trail. And that's something that's really easy to fake. And that's part of what where we could see the DNA barcoding or other DNA methods kind of being used to combat this problem is being able to take that kind of trust factor a little bit out of it. And the vast majority of fishermen and sellers are probably doing the right thing, as Bob said. But the problem is those few that are not have a really easy way of sort of mixing their products in and getting them illegal products and by just putting a different label on them. So what we're hoping to be able to do is actually link in with existing certification schemes. So you might have heard of like MSC, for example, so the Marine Stewardship Council. I know you guys participated in the markets or race. You might have seen that when you were buying fish. But basically working in this idea of let's actually authenticate what the product is to go along with this paper trail and go along with this other certification. And I think once that becomes more readily available to companies and more reasonably priced for companies, and that they have a better understanding of how the technology fits in, we're going to see a lot better uptake of them. There are also a few new regulations in the EU and increasingly actually now in North America that may see a big shift as well. So it's sort of a mixture of the regulatory space and what companies have to do, and then what's actually available for them to take part in to protect their supply.
Thank you, Amanda. Other questions?
Is food fraud threatening other endangered species, or is it mostly just fish and seafood?
That's a really good question. Is food fraud impacting other endangered species, or is it mainly seafood? Most of the work we've done here has, of course, been focused on seafood. But we have done work in collaboration with the U.S. Food and Drug Administration, where they suspected or received a tip that someone was selling sausage and ground meats online, sort of specialty game meats, and that they were actually selling endangered species. And so they sent sausages to the Center for Biodiversity Genomics for testing, and we actually confirmed their suspicion that they were actually selling endangered species on the internet to people who were wanting to try it. I think a lot of people who are raised with a conservation ethos would find that disturbing, but unfortunately there are some people in the world who would find that as a status symbol, or just maybe out of curiosity would like to try and eat endangered species. And so we have seen some evidence that they're making it into the food supply. Is that a common occurrence? I don't think so. But I think that we have to recognize that this extends beyond just the proteins that we're eating, but natural health products, herbs and spices, a lot of these things that are wildcrafted or gathered from wild sources, like seafood, are being exploited at or beyond sustainable levels. And as our global population continues to expand and there's more pressure to have access to more of these wildcrafted mushrooms or different herbs used in traditional Chinese medicine or other natural health product preparations, that we will likely see evidence of declines in more than just seafood. And in fact, I'm sure there are examples we could point to in the literature.
So is there anything that we can do to help in these regards?
So what can you do to help in respect to food fraud? I think one of the things that is helpful is to ask questions. You know, if retailers or restaurateurs don't really think you care about what they're serving, then there's not much incentive for them to go out of their way to source authentic product or label correctly. So typically when I go to a fish and chips restaurant, despite all the testing I've done, I still eat fish and chips from time to time. But I ask, what species is it? And I've found sometimes that you don't always need a DNA test to tell this apart. I think as consumers, we're a bit victims of a shifting baseline. So if half the time you think you eat cod, you're not actually eating cod, you don't really have a good sense of what cod is supposed to taste like or what texture it would have. I suspect if you grew up in the Maritimes eating fresh cod on a regular basis, you could often tell things like bassa just from the texture. So I've started to notice, now that I can authenticate certain things with DNA, sometimes I've bitten into some fish and chips and they've told me it's cod and I'm pretty sure it's not. And in some cases, I've talked to the restaurant about it, and in one case, the proprietor brought me into the cold storage room of his shop and said, look, it says cod on the box that I bought. So he could be a victim of fraud. It may not be the retailer who is perpetrating this. In other cases, when I've asked questions about this, the chef will refuse to speak to me. And so that kind of makes me wonder, well, maybe they're aware that they're buying a cheaper fish and selling it as something more expensive. So I think the first thing you can do is ask questions. Then I think the next thing you can do is to give feedback to our regulators. Right now in North America, we don't require a species name on the packaging. The European Union, for example, has moved to requiring that a species name, in addition to a common name, be included on the packaging. They also want to know what region the species was harvested from, and also what method it was caught by, whether it was seine netting or long lining, so that consumers have more information to make informed decisions. Right now, Canada is one of the top 10 seafood producing nations in the world. We're exporting high quality seafood to the European Union that adheres to their labeling requirements, but the labeling requirements we have here in North America don't match that. So it's harder for us to be informed. And right now, until people provide feedback to our government that we want that level of information, they probably won't impose it on industry because it comes with an additional cost. Excellent question, though. I think we're getting some online questions, too. So if anyone else in the class has another question, we'll take one from you, or would you prefer that we move over to taking some of the online questions?
So when you're talking about the retailers not perhaps knowing that what they're selling is mislabeled, how do you consider, especially from the testing just done that we participated, telling the retailers, because some of the labels tell you about the mislabeling in case they don't know?
Yeah, we have talked to them in some cases, and it's a challenge for them. They want to source ethically and sustainably, but they also have to be competitive in the marketplace. And so they would like to see, some of the feedback we've had from the retail industry is that they would like to see regulations requiring everyone in the industry to move forward with testing so that no one company bears too much of the financial cost. Other companies, small scale companies like Organic Ocean, have said we're going to voluntarily start testing our products and using that as a market advantage to sell to the top restaurants in Canada and the chefs who really care about authenticity. So we are starting to see some voluntary uptake. In other sectors, in things like natural health products, where the U.S. Attorney General issued a cease and desist order for selling fraudulently labeled products in the United States, that regulatory pressure has driven some companies to start testing so that they can resume selling their products in major retail stores. So it has to be a combination, I think, but ultimately it all starts with consumer awareness and consumer interest. You know, if people recognize that there are issues with fraud and they want DNA-tested products, the market will respond. So with respect to some of the questions we have online, when you're doing things like finding fish fraud, do you ever have people who don't want to believe your work and challenge the science of it? That's an interesting question. What we've seen in some of our work with the U.S. Food and Drug Administration is that when they were trying to identify seafood fraud from irregularities in the paper trail, typically companies would fight back and argue that it was a simple mistake. However, in cases where they could bring DNA evidence to bear, quite often the perpetrators would settle out of court and simply say, yes, okay, you caught us. So I think DNA evidence is seen as being somewhat more robust, although it certainly can be challenged more on the chain of custody of how do we know that the samples weren't mixed up between the time they were collected and went to the lab. Another anonymous question from the web. Is DNA barcoding used in criminal investigations? Yes, we've had some collaborations with the RCMP where they've found evidence in the case of a hammer that, say, had some blood on it, and they wanted to identify the species of animal or person that the blood came from. So we can't actually individuate different people. That's a different technique known as DNA fingerprinting. But when it comes to at least putting a species ID on some of these kinds of forensic materials, yes, there are different cases that have involved criminal investigations where we've used DNA barcoding to identify the species of origin. And sometimes that even relates to the sale of CITES listed or endangered species in the market. We've collaborated with Environment Canada and other agencies to help identify processed remains that are being sold when they shouldn't be. Online question. When you're doing things like finding fish fraud, do you ever have people who don't want to believe you? Yep, we hit that one. So I think we're about out of time. We're going to thank everyone for their participation. We've enjoyed having the opportunity to talk to you a little bit about our work here. Hope you found it of interest. There will be a recording of today's event available at letstalkdna.ca shortly. And teachers and students can also find more resources free online at explorecuriosity.org. Thank you and happy DNA Day, everyone.